With study to studio, I get the best, quickest results by going out with a particular project in mind. I envision a moment I want to depict, and then I go into the field focused on gathering specific references that I'd like to include in the studio painting. If I don't go out with a goal, it's so easy to enjoy the moment but come back with nothing really useful. By having a goal, I can be very selective in what I choose to sketch and photograph, and then get right to work once I return. It's a very efficient process. For the project that is the subject of this video, I wanted to depict the quality of light that's unusual in Arizona in winter. We don't get clouds here very often, so on an overcast day, I decided to head out into the field to gather references. As for location, I had in mind the end of a small canyon, where a thick, sedimentary rock layer underlying the earth had collapsed, forming an interesting arrangement of large rocks and deep shadow. I'd painted at that spot several times before, so I was very familiar with the lay of the land and knew what to expect. My sketching gear was always packed and ready to go, so I loaded up and drove out to the canyon. Once at my parking spot, I took a short walk before unpacking to relax and to look at several possibilities for setting up. On an overcast day, I'm always looking for the strongest contrast, which helps with creating a strong design. I like the deep shadow of the collapsed rock shelf, and also the dark shapes of the surrounding junipers. Once I picked my location, I unpacked my stool and settled in to make a couple of pencil sketches. My tools were simple, a mechanical pencil loaded with a soft 6B lead and a small sketchbook. I first sketched the rockfall. I could have simply snapped a photo instead, but I felt it was very important for me to get a handle on how the boulders jutted out from the wall behind them and how they nestled in the shadows. Nothing gives you a better sense of the way your subject sits in space than by drawing it from life. Unless you're doing stereoscopic photography, the photos won't convey this information. What's more, the act of drawing lets you engage in and benefit from kinesthetic learning. Your hand, eye, and brain work together and learn more about the shapes than by studying the photos alone. For this first sketch, I paid a great deal of attention to form and shadow. I also made a second sketch. This one is what I call a lay of the land sketch, an overview of my scene and an initial design stab. In it, I also tried to capture a pleasing pattern of clouds that I knew would be gone by the time I pulled out my camera. Again, there's a certain amount of kinesthetic learning going on when you make this or any sketch. Once I finished my pencil sketches, I pulled out my camera. Photos are good for only two things, capturing detail and serving as a memory jog when in the studio. They're not good for color, value, or drawing. There's no camera yet invented that has the sensitivity of the eye to color and value, or the capacity of the brain to interpret these holistically. Cameras, especially point-and-shoot cameras with tiny lenses and smartphones, distort perspective. I took snapshots of anything I felt would be important and useful to me in the studio. The rockfall, of course, plus some of the junipers, clouds, and wide-angle overviews. Camera memory is cheap, and you're better off taking more photos than you need. Still, as I snapped away, I tried to be discriminating. I decided what would be important in the studio session and made sure I took photos of these elements. Next, I put away the camera and pulled out my 6x8 Gorilla Painter thumb box. This little beauty holds up to four 6x8 panels and has room for paint tubes, a container for mineral spirits, and more. I got this from Judson's Art Outfitters, which specializes in gear for outdoor painters. What I like about this box is it's great for color studies, not unless you're a painter of miniatures with lots of time and a very small brush, so it forces me to paint only large shapes. Plus, I can hold it easily in my lap, and it weighs very little. With this box, I typically use just three colors, but because subjects that are lit with a soft, overcast light tend to have a great deal of subtlety in color, I added a few more. For this outing, I used the following paints from Gamelin Artist Colors: Hansa Yellow Light, Yellow Ochre, Burnt Sienna, Cadmium Red Light, Permanent Alizarin Crimson, Ultramarine Blue, Phthalo Green, and of course White. These allowed me to describe the full range of colors I saw. Sometimes I make two or three color studies, but for this project I used just one panel. Looking at the sketch, you can definitely tell what it represents, but the scene is still very abstract and simplified. I didn't concern myself with drawing accurately or perfecting the design. Instead, I focused on getting the color relationships right. For example, how dark and warm an orange is this shape when compared to the adjacent shape which seems lighter and cooler and more of a blue-gray. You can push this kind of color sketch to abstraction if you want. It doesn't have to look like anything, just so long as the spots of color relate to one another accurately.